When was the last time you spent 4 hours debugging a data pipeline? It happened to me one day, and to be precise, it happened to me one night. I woke up at 2 a.m. for no apparent reason, and I had a feeling that I should check our Slack channel that delivers alerts when something is wrong. In retrospect, that was the mistake number one, because in the Slack channel, I saw that one of the data pipelines is failing, and was the most important one. If that one doesn't work, everything else will fail too, and we'll spend the whole working day restarting them one by one, and of course, manually checking the data. But it was still 2 a.m. I could still fix it, at least that was my idea. Sure, there would be a 1 hour delay, maybe 2 hours, but at least we will not waste the whole working day fixing the problems. I didn't have to do that, but I felt that if I'm the first person to see the problem and I can still mitigate it, I must do it. In that respect, that was my second mistake. While looking around for the cause of the bug, I saw that a code trend was merged before all of the tests were executed. Apparently, the author wanted to stop working at 5 p.m. and didn't wait for the tests. I couldn't be mad at this person. It took a lot of time to wait for the tests in that project. Unfortunately, a test failed about 20 minutes later, and nobody noticed that. I could revert the trend, assume that the previous version still works because it worked yesterday, and go back to sleep. Or I could write a fix, wait until the tests pass, deploy it, and run a fixed version in production. Of course, reverting the trend means that I will have to fix the problem twice, so I decided to save some time, at least that was my idea. And in retrospect, I decided to make my mistake number three. Some moments later, I heard my alarm clock ringing, and it turned out it was already 6 a.m. The fix took about 4 hours, and I had to rework it anyway, because what seemed like a brilliant idea at 3 a.m. wasn't even close to the working or optimal solution. Before switching to data engineering, I was a backend developer for 8 years. I have seen projects with no test and projects with 100% test coverage of useless tests that didn't validate anything, but existed only to raise the test coverage metric. On the other hand, there were projects with useful tests with decent coverage, but people complained about test execution time. In those projects, it was unacceptable to wait for the test longer than 2 minutes. People complained if it took more than 30 seconds. And data engineering is somewhere in the middle between no tests and tests running for hours. If I have to wait 3 minutes for Apache Spark to start, I must be happy if my tests run in less than 5 minutes. At some point, you need half an hour to run them, and allowing merging before tests pass seems like an obvious and reasonable practice. At some point, you accept that this is the reality of data engineering. This is how we work. We cannot change that, but can we? It might be a fork, but data engineering is just software engineering. So let's start at the beginning. What makes software useful? I think it is all about trust. Oh, these slides don't work perfectly. If we don't trust the software, we don't want to use it. And similarly, if we don't trust data pipelines, nobody is going to use the data that they produce. So how do we build trustworthy data pipelines? Let me show you something. This is the universal software architecture chart. However, today it is going to be a data pipeline. Of course, this is a simplified example, but ridiculously oversimplified example. But this is what we need for teaching or training. In reality, we might have multiple inputs, multiple output, and processing part branches out into multiple sub-processes. Never mind, let's focus on something simple. What part of this pipeline can break? Well, every part of it can. We might get invalid input data. We might fail to load it correctly. We might make a mistake in the processing code. We might write the data in the wrong location. The output format might no longer be correct, or we can break something downstream. Finally, the scheduling mechanism might break, and we will not run the pipeline at all. Christopher Beck, a co-author of DevOps Manifesto and the DevOps Cookbook, says that we have two kinds of moving parts in data pipelines. It is either a value pipeline that is running in production, the code stays the same, but the data changes, or it is an innovation pipeline. When the code is still in development, the test data is constant, but we modify the implementation. Because of that, we will focus on two things: making sure that the code works as expected and validating the data. However, before we even start, we have to simplify the pipeline and get the code under control. Do you remember what the buzzword functional programming was a few years ago? Every conference was full of talks about monads, monoids, Scala, and Haskell. We can ignore all of that. Well, maybe not all of it, because we will need deterministic output, and for that we need pure functions and immutability. How do we achieve immutability? After all, we can change everything in a database or an S3 bucket. First of all, whatever enters the pipeline is immutable by definition. It should be stored separately. I prefer to write the input data into a separate bucket as fast as possible. This gives me two benefits. First of all, I can check what data was received from the external system, so it's helpful for auditing, and we can run the pipeline if anything fails. Of course, keeping the copy of the input data increases the cost, so most likely we'll have to remove it at some point. Will it be after 30 days or 30 minutes? I don't know, and that depends on the cost you want to spend on storage and on the kind of data that you're storing. But first of all, what is a pure function? A pure function is a function which output depends only on the input. So this definition does not resemble anything we have in data engineering, because when we run a Spark cluster, we kind of have one global state that is modifiable, and it's even worse because it's scattered across multiple nodes. So how do we achieve immutability in such environment? First, we can extract the part of the pipeline that is processing the data and isolate it from the parts that are loading the input data and storing it. If we go back to this part, but then it's obviously this middle part. So we isolate the part that is loading the data from the part that is saving it into the output, and we have the middle part, which in our case may be seen as a logical pure function. Of course, when we run it on the cluster, it is not a pure function, but for our purposes, it is good enough. And so what are the benefits of pure functions? Well, it is trivial to test them, because if the output depends only on the input, we can easily write a lot of very, very simple tests. And speaking of tests, please take a look at this horrible example. Is it readable? What does it even do? You'll need to spend a lot of time reading the code to figure it out. There are some mocks at the top. We pass a lot of arguments to the object, you'll see in the middle. I bet if we look at the implementation of the function that we test, we will see that many of those arguments are not even used, but the constructor requires them, so we have to pass them anyway. And of course, I chose Java, so the example looks worse. And look at the verification part. What do we expect? Well, I need to search for the Jira ticket and read the description. It is not obvious. There's no meaning in this test method. And also, I'm sure that it was a test written after the implementation. The author wrote the code, tested it manually, and was told to write a test. So a test has been written, or rather copy-pasted from another test and modified a little bit. Because if the author started with a test, there would be no needless parameters, because who wants to write four variable names when you only need one? And I think that is quite easy to make a similar mess when we are testing data pipelines. We need extensive setup, just like in this example, or even worse. We create multiple data frames containing at least a few rows. The assertions are never simple, because the pipelines usually don't do very simple stuff. The tests are long, and when they fail, it is hard to tell what caused the failure. How do we improve it? The setup and the assertions are kind of technical details. If we keep them like in this example, we hide the business meaning in tons of mess. So there is a testing method that separates a description of the expected behavior from the technical details of the implementation, and it is called behavior-driven development. And in the next example, we separate the human readable description of the specification from the test code and the production code. The specification should be easy to understand. At least that is our goal. If the specification is easy to understand, we should be kind of sure that we can easily spot a mistake in the test implementation. Of course, there are some edge cases. So we no longer have to wonder whether a strange looking line of code was intentional or not. But what is the most important thing? The scenario should describe a business rule, not the implementation detail. Let's take a look at the one on the top. This is the correct one. The specification describes the intent, not technical details. The example at the bottom is a terrible idea, because I bet that it is the specification for that looks exactly the same like the test implementation. It is a waste of time because we are doing double the work, but have no benefits of doing the work at all. That's the test written by people who claim that automated testing doesn't work. But testing the code is the easy part, sort of. Software engineers have been doing it for decades, at least they should. We have functional tests, integration tests, end-to-end testing, unit tests, and long discussions about differences between those kinds of tests and proper naming. We can find a way to test the code. What about testing the data? In production, data changes all the time. Other teams release new features or start sending different kinds of events, and we should be prepared for that. There are three ways. We can write validation rules that reject everything unusual, but in this case, the data engineering team becomes a huge bottleneck, preventing everyone else from achieving any goal. We can accept almost everything as an input and hope that nobody makes a mistake, and yeah, good luck with that. Or we can create a separate storage for data that is correct and separate it from the unexpected values, but we keep both. So at some point later, we can update the pipeline and process everything again. Something like in this example, we have the storage bucket from the incorrect values that didn't pass the validation, whatever the rules are. Why do we do it? What's the point? First of all, we cannot let the incorrect data into the pipeline because it is too difficult, too time-consuming, just too expensive to fix the problems later if that happens. That's why you have the error bucket at the beginning of the ingestion pipeline. If something is not correct, we put it in the separate bucket and let someone review the data. Should the pipeline continue running if we detect a problem? I don't know. That depends what we are processing. In case of medical data or financial data, probably we will stop. But and of course, there is some manual process, but at least we can detect the problem early. But that is not enough. We have tested our code and the data, but that is not 100% bulletproof. We should test the data once again before we write it to the output location, just to be sure that we don't propagate problems downstream. Does this sound like contract testing? Well, a little bit, but please don't expect that other teams that are using your data will write the contract test for you. They will not do it, and honestly, you wouldn't do it either. So how do we test the data? There are tools like Great Expectation or AWSDQ that let us define validation rules for the data. In case of AWSDQ, we can even run anomaly detection. But even the simplest implementation, like adding an additional column with the validation results and using it to split the data into correct and incorrect bucket, will help us improve the pipeline. It is a good starting point. Not perfect, but good enough. There's one more thing we can do. What if we didn't allow incorrect data into the data lake at all? What if we had a sort of data version control system with branches and pull requests, and we rejected branches that don't pass validation? Well, I cannot promise you pull requests for data. That would be tricky and kind of useless. But we can have branches. If you use tools like Lagerverse, we can create a new branch for every data pipeline and merge the changes if the main branch into the main branch after testing. So let's imagine a data pipeline. We create a new branch using the checkout. We ingest the input data into a separate branch, run all of our tests for the input, then do the processing, run some additional tests after that, and if everything is fine, we merge the data into the main branch. What is the benefit of that? The yellow part, the main branch, always contains only the complete and valid data. What is even more important, such data versioning tools like Lagerverse handle merges as an atomic action. So either all of the files get merged or none of them is merged. It means that we no longer need tricks like market files, status databases, or any other ugly hack that you might invent to prevent processes that are reading the data from reading values that are not completed yet. If something exists in the main branch, we can just assume that we can use it. Still, the tests that we have seen so far are not enough. In the end, there is the infrastructure and scripts that we run occasionally. Do you know what happened to me recently? I was working on deploying a TensorFlow machine learning model, and I had my deployment script that I was using a few times in the past, so I knew it worked. I had the new model, and I wanted to deploy it as a SageMaker endpoint. Of course, the deployment failed, and yeah, it was strange because I didn't change the script, so I assumed it must work. I needed to test it somehow. The only difference was the new model, so I tried to deploy an older version that was already running in production, and it failed too. The script was the same, the model was exactly the same, the deployment pipeline was defined in CloudFormation, and I could see that there were no manual changes. And here is the error message that I saw. It seems that the version was missing. I started looking to find the SageMaker code. Fortunately, there is a GitHub repository with some of the code used by SageMaker. After a while, I'll find the problematic line of code. Look, it removes leading zeros from the version ID. And the problem is it removes all of the zeros, even if the zero is the only thing in a version ID. Do you know what is the problem? I have one model version per file, so all of them have version zero. I had to repackage the model files, changing the version 0 to version 1, and run the script again. This time it worked, but I wasn't happy. See, it was a machine learning deployment script. The data scientists need a few weeks, sometimes months, to create an improved model that we might need to deploy. I will run the script several times per year, but I really want to find out that the script doesn't work anymore on the day when I'm supposed to deploy a new model. Of course not. So there's one more thing we have to test, the scripts. I run my deployment scripts in an AWS code pipeline that is scheduled to run every day in the morning. It deploys the SageMaker endpoint, sends a few test requests, compares the predictions with the expected values, and then it removes the endpoints. If anything breaks, I will get an early morning email with the error message. That is not the best email you can see in the morning, of course. But it is way better than learning that your deployment code doesn't work anymore when you urgently need to deploy a new model. But this does not apply only to scripts. If you have a pipeline that is running once a month because it generates the monthly report, you should do yourself a favor and schedule additional runs at least once a week. If anything breaks, you will have time to fix it before the CEO starts asking where is the report. Okay, but enough talking. I have a homework for you. It's not going to be easy. There are two software engineering books that offer tons of ideas for data engineering. The first one is Effective Engineer by Edmund Lau. It is a book about focusing on high leverage tasks, optimizing the feedback loop, shortening cycle time, and quickly validating the ideas. It's also a book about pragmatic automation, so without over engineering it, and choosing the right metrics. Basically, it is a DevOps book for software engineers. The second book is The Pragmatic Programmer by Andrew Hunt and David Thomas. It's a book about writing good enough software, building prototypes, defining useful tests without over-engineering it again, and making a minimal but still working version of the application as soon as possible. But when you finish reading the software books, there's one more thing, a bonus homework, but still mandatory. The last book does not contain any code. It is a book about writing. It's On Writing Well by William Zinsner. And I show it you for two reasons. First of all, because I would like to see more well-written documentation. And second, because it helps you to clarify your idea, express them more precisely, and avoid needlessly overcomplicated language, which is very, very helpful when you are writing code. Hey, my name is Bartosz Mikulski, and that was a short list of simple but time-consuming tasks which you have to do to build trustworthy data pipelines.